Everyone, it's great to see everybody again tonight for our monthly live webcast on culture. And tonight we have a wonderful presenter. We have Shawna Morton Cain here with us tonight. She is a Cherokee National Treasure for basketry, and she has brought a lot of material to share with everyone. And so I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Shawna. It's also great to have her husband, Roger Cain, here with us as well, who I believe may be giving a presentation in the future, I hope. Yes? Okay. Okay. So Shawna's work is exquisite. I've been watching Cherokee artists since I was in my mid-teens. And sometimes you can look at people's work and know it's their work just by the quality of it. And that is certainly the case here. And Shawna works with some of the more difficult material that there is to work with. Her work is beautiful, it's exquisite, it's ancient. And so it's an honor to have Cherokee National Treasure here, Shawna Morton Cain. Wado.
Thank you. Thank you, Donnie. Okay, so I'm on here. Well, okay, I know a lot of people in this room. We know that, right? Now the camera's on, so. Before I just start talking about basketry in general, are there any questions about basketry in general before I just start? Because, you know, I want to talk about, I'm ready, but I want to talk about what you want, what questions you might have about basketry, Cherokee basketry.
How long have you been making baskets?
Okay, I was supposed to introduce myself and say that. Thank you, Tammy. Well, let me see. I started with Thelma Forest back when I was in, oh my goodness, it was summer camp. You know those summer camps? Emily's here. Did you go to those summer camps sometimes Cherokee Nation had for you? Well, the summer activities?
No.
Yeah, so I went to those camps because I'm sure it was annoying and my mom wanted to get rid of me in the summer. Or she was going to class, she says sometimes, like at NSU. But I remember it was in the Cherokee Courthouse, and it was with Thelma Forest, and I remember that I just loved it. I didn't like making the God's eyes. I didn't like what else we were beating and things like that. But once I got my hands on weaving a basket, you know, all the little smart aleck remarks about, she's so quiet, she's being so good, you know. So I got praised a lot for it by Thelma. So I can definitely say that Thelma Forest was my first teacher, and she is a Cherokee National Treasure. She was one of the earliest in basketry, and she's done so much to, you know, further Cherokee basketry. And that's a cool thing to be able to say, is that you learn from so-and-so. I didn't learn from my family. It wasn't something passed down to me through my family. A lot of people like to hear that story, and if it'll help me sell a basket, no, I'm kidding. I really am kidding. I don't ever lie about it. But, yeah. My mom and dad definitely supported me in the arts and everything. So later, I became a public school teacher. And I know some people in this room who watched me do that. And we would do a lot. In fact, Emily, I'm going to say your name again. Remember when we made all those baskets in class and Victor Wildcat came? And
remember when we'd go places and make all those baskets?
So how many, yeah, we would make, what, hundreds of baskets with little kids. And yeah, so that was when Emily was in high school. So it was cool to teach that. Oh, yeah.
Not that long ago.
Yeah, it wasn't. No, it was just a few years ago. But that was a neat class. It was multicultural studies, native studies. And so we started inviting people to come in. You probably remember that, too. You got to do different projects, and you can invite elders in to talk. So we had a basket weaver come in, and I cannot remember her name. But I remember thinking, what is she weaving? Because I was weaving with, this is a commercial basket, and this we see a lot of these, and they're beautiful. And I do want to talk about the difference in a basket weaver and a basket maker, so maybe I should go there now. So I have been weaving that long, since I was about 10 or so. That's the answer to your question there. So, but I put it down for a long time and picked it back up when I was in my mid-20s. So this is a commercial reed basket. It is still a natural material, and I'm going to pass it around, and I want y'all to feel of it, because I'm going to pass around different kinds of baskets so you can feel of them. That's your first way to tell if it's a natural material or if it's not natural, but if it's a Cherokee material, because all of ours are shiny and they're slick. So I'm going to pass this one around. It's very beautiful. This is made by Feather Trevino now. We'll start then with the other ones. But it's a beautiful shape, and that is a Cherokee double wall basket. We call it an Oklahoma double wall basket. Because in Cherokee, in North Carolina, there's not a lot or very much at all evidence of these kind of baskets. They're woven from vines from the inside and brought down to make two walls. In Cherokee, what we have more evidence of is they make a single wall and use white oak in them. So this is, we like to call this our little invention, you know, for Oklahoma Cherokees. So feel how shiny this one is when you get to feel how slick. Oh, did I say? This is honeysuckle? Which we know, we found out later, that's the cool thing about studying something, because we did start studying it. Honeysuckle is not indigenous to North America. I knew he was going to correct me. Go right ahead.
There is one indigenous species.
You have to speak loudly. Okay, then quit interrupting me. There we go. If you're going to interrupt me, you're going to talk.
Is that all right?
Yeah, tell them about honeysuckle.
There is an indigenous honeysuckle species here in North America, but it's not as prominent as the Asian honeysuckle species that we know here in North America that's really prominent. So, yeah.
So, and that's correct. But we found that out after we were weaving, you know, because, okay, so the woman who came to class, the elder, and spoke in our class, and basketry wasn't on my mind. Managing all these kids and everything was on my mind, and I just can't remember who she was. But she was a Cherokee elder, and she talked about buckbrush. And that was the first time I heard about buckbrush. Now, this is honeysuckle. Okay, and that's the basket we just passed around. And this, you know, it's Asian, but it's been planted here. It was gathered here. I didn't gather this. This was gathered by a woman who wanted to remain anonymous, who lives at Rocky Ford. So these go for about $40 a hank if you want to buy one. But I don't sell mine once I buy it because it's a big deal to get it. However, I do know how to clean. That's where I want to talk about makers and weavers. That's what I want you to take away today, the difference between a basket maker and a weaver. In Cherokee, North Carolina, they defined a basket maker and a basket weaver. Their basket weavers got together. And this is written about a bit in Sarah Hill's Weaving New Worlds, if you ever want to read about a good basket book, Cherokee Baskets. But the women, there was a difference in those who were gathering all their own materials. See how brown this is? It still has to be boiled, it still has to be cleaned, it still has to be dyed. And this is buckbrush, but when it's clean, it'll look very similar. Which way? We'll go this way.
What did you say that was?
But this is buckbrush, the straight. So I'll tell you the story. My stories will meander. I will get back to buckbrush. Bring me back to that one when I finish talking about a maker. Well, this woman was a maker. I was a weaver. I knew how to weave, but I was getting my materials at a craft store. And this is a commercial material. Now, that doesn't mean it's not a real material. It doesn't mean it's a bad material. It just means you're weaving someone else's material, right? So, I'm going to keep it going the same way so they can feel the difference in commercial and traditional materials. You can see it looks like it came out of a machine, and this is the basket I made. And if you'll just keep passing those, did it go around? Okay.
Both of those personal buckbrush?
The stems are the buckbrush, those are buckbrush, and this basket is buckbrush. And that is honeysuckle. So these are the vines that we use, buckbrush and honeysuckle. There are two Cherokee vines. Am I making sense? All right. So this woman, when she came to my room that day and brought this buckbrush basket in, I was a little humiliated that I didn't even know what buckbrush was. You know, that I should know that.
Shawna, how does that grow?
That grows in runners on the ground. All of these vines grow runners on the ground. And buckbrush is a shrub about this tall. And
do you cut it or pull it?
You have to get down on your hands and knees and crawl around. And we call them gorillas in the mist shots, because we always look like gorillas, you know, climbing around in there. Because you are, you're down on all fours and snip, snip. And that's why you can't find butt brush baskets. If you find one for it, ever under $300, $400, you are getting a steal because it is so hard to process and hard to work. It is indigenous. And we know that Cherokees and other Indians have been weaving with butt brush for a very long time. All right. I'm trying not to be boring, so without weaving a basket.
This one's heavy.
Yeah, so that's the butt brush. See how strong?
So this is one of the door prizes.
Yeah. Yeah, I told you I have a car broken down, right, to fix. Okay, no, I'm just teasing. So these are all the natural material baskets I'm showing you. This is the third medium that we like to use. So we've talked about honeysuckle, buck brush. I'm doing a terrible job at this. And here's river cane. And this is my favorite thing to weave with. And the reason I started weaving with river cane is because we couldn't find anyone else here doing it. And we thought it was really neat if we would figure out how to do it. So that's why we did river cane. Do I need to test you guys?
Yes.
Why did I start doing river cane?
Nobody else was making that.
Thank you, Emily. She was always an A student. So, yeah, no one else was making it. No one else was doing it that we knew. But we had heard all these stories of people who had maybe two generations ago or a generation ago. So, everybody's talking, so. And that's good. Talk. Roger's going to show us how to split some river cane here in just a second. You ready? So this one right here, this is a single wall river cane basket, and I'm going to pass it around. And remember, it's going for sale tomorrow, so don't break it. It's still wet. But this is like a gathering basket, you know, if you're going to go out and gather, if I was going to gather poke or something light, it wouldn't be nuts. It's not strong enough for nuts. Maybe acorns.
Shawna, what's this other one over here?
Oh, thank you, Emily. I should have had you made me a syllabus for this class, or at least a plan.
That would be mom.
White oak. And this is actually, some of you probably recognize this look. What's the name of that family? It always comes to me in Gibson. The Gibson family in Arkansas, right over the border, right over into Fayetteville in that area. They make these baskets. So this isn't a Cherokee basket, but I don't do white oak. We can split it a bit, but I can't split it well enough to weave with it. I mean, in Cherokee, they can weave with white oak this small. This is a little double wall one. But this isn't white oak. This is.
Shawna, that's a basket maker. Remember what that George was.
Yes. Yep. That's probably who it was. It probably wasn't even a woman. It was probably a man.
He was doing split oak. And then he could still, he would slice the cherokee and refurbishing chairs that he made.
Yeah. And see, I've been hearing about George Forkiller so much, and now for you to say that, it's like.
Yeah, he was somebody. He was like, I remember in that class, he was somebody's grandfather.
See, now I just totally remember that, whether you're making it up or not, I think, yeah. Here's this one. And this is one, it's okay, it's a commercial material. And then this is a river cane. Good question, I'm glad you asked it. Okay, while Roger's splitting, I just got the question, do we do the dyes ourselves, or do we, how do we get the dyes? So we're going to get right to that as soon as Roger splits his cane here and shows us how it's done. Now there is a thing called a bamboo splitter you can use, but Roger likes to show off his skill and show he doesn't need one. He does. I use the splitter to go down once in a while. He keeps me honest enough. You're showing how to do river cane. Now you.
So first you half the cane. You start with the whole stalk of cane.
I'm holding the microphone for you.
Like this, okay? You hold the whole stalk of cane like this, and you'll. I got to point out to this right here, is that this piece of cane right here, is coming from, at least a 30 to 40 year old cane brake, okay? This right here is It was about 2 weeks old cane, river cane right here. And for it to have a big enough cane break to produce cane this size right here, it takes about 20 to 30 years to establish an ecosystem to make this kind of cane. And that's what we're trying to help us get the river cane more established and better accessible to native people. So that's what I want to stress to you on that, because it looks like it's easy and everything, but it's kind of hard. And what we have here is dried cane. This has been dried for about maybe 9 months or so. But we had to learn to work with dry cane, because in 2011, all the river cane here in northeast Oklahoma all froze up and died off, and northwest Arkansas did as well. So in 2011, for about 3 or 4 years, we weren't able to really make big river cane baskets like Shawna likes to make. So we had to get used to working with this dead cane, and I like it. And so it's something that it was kind of neat how an environmental thing happened that made you learn something new, and you're able to, like, ooh, that makes it even better. And we get cooler colors this way, too. So
okay, which goes to your question and gets me back on track, because we talked on the carway here. Okay, now what are we going to talk about? I mean, exactly. And one of the things we wanted to talk about was conservation. Because if we've learned anything through making basketry, it's that these materials are hard to come by. And anything that you do pluck from the earth, you know, we pretend like it's screaming and it's dying. We don't waste anything anymore. We used to, and we've learned not to. I was telling him it's pretty neat. A lot of people will come and interview us, like for their dissertations or for, you know, professors and stuff, and then they'll write about us, but they'll change our names and then send it to us. And one of the things that one anthropologist wrote about us was that there were a group of other Cherokees that thought we were using too much bloodroot to do our basketry, because it's also a medicine. And at first you just go, ah. And then you think, wait a minute, somebody really was saying that. These were some elders, so we really need to think more about that. So I just brought a little bit of bloodroot today. And this is, because you asked the question about dye, this is a very traditional dye. We went back to the University of Arkansas into anthropology, and Roger graduated, and I'm still almost there.
PhD.
Yeah, but you graduated with your master's in ethnobiology and anthropology. And so we really got into studying and learning about the plants. So I'm going to pass this bloodroot around, but you know, when you do, I've learned to not think of it as a color, but as something that's like we think of tobacco. You saw the one basket had tobacco in it. Well, you know, is it a Marlboro or is it the other kind of tobacco or what? Well, that was grown by someone, so I care about that tobacco and take care of it. Same thing with this. This will go back home to make a dye, and the most we get a whole year is a gallon. And we make sure, Raj, you want to help me?
Yep.
We make sure what? Tell me about the pod and all that stuff.
So we make sure after whenever bloodroot, it's one of the first flowers of spring. It's one of the.
Bloodroot is one of the. Is it on? I don't know.
I don't think
it's on.
Yes, it is.
It is on? Okay. But the bloodroot is one of the first flowers of spring. And so it's easy to identify in the springtime.
Go ahead and touch
it. So. If you really don't know what you're doing when you're gathering it, you'll gather it as soon as you see the flower. But from that flower is where the seed pod starts. And so in that seed pod, there's about a dozen little seeds that start in that thing, in that little flower, and then it takes ants to take it back into the ground. So we let the flowers all go off and die off and get the seeds planted before we go harvest the bloodroot. So we'll wait till May and June to go harvest instead of harvesting when it first flowers. And first, like, it's easy to identify because it's the only one out there. And plus, there's no ticks out there at the time. So there's like, do you go ahead and do it because there's no ticks, or are you smart and treat the plant right and wait till and fight the ticks for it, which is better for the plant, you know? So that's something you as a human have to approach about when you're working with plants, is that do you meet your deadline or your schedule, or do you let the plant do its schedule first? And I think it's more of a Cherokee way to let the plant do its schedule and not rush it and not harm it. And so there's a lot of processes in that too, so. I'm through off my bandwagon on this stuff.
So if you haven't touched the bloodroot yet, it's coming around. You guys didn't get any, did you? I'll give you a big one and you can all pop it. And after we pop it and everything, I'll pick it up from you so we can still use it in a dye. But we don't use it for medicine because we're not medicine. You know, that would be for someone who does medicine. Are you, did you try popping it yet? It's got orange. It's very, yeah. It doesn't stay too long on your skin, but this will take off warts. But don't do it because you're supposed to know how. Yeah, you don't have any warts, yeah. So anyway, we take it back now.
It's also good to warm your animals with
too. But for our culture, it is considered, you know, a medicine and sacred, so we're very careful. And I only use it now. Just made this decision like last year. In competition pieces or a special gift, something like that. Because when you're in competition with your baskets, you have to mark this little box whether you use natural dyes or you use commercial dyes. So to answer your question, everything here is a natural dye as far as I know. This one is too old for me to know, but it came from Cherokee, North Carolina, and I was told it was butternut. And so I usually don't pass
butternut
this one
is the brown.
Around because I bought it this.
And then the middle orange, middle is blood root in the middle.
Yeah, so the dark color. The what looks black is butternut, which is something we don't have here. All right, so where? Okay, the other dye. So you saw that dye. And you see in this basket I've used brown. This is the, remember this, Emily? We used to cook this when I worked at Stillwell High School. We cooked some of this on a burner in the whole school. Woo! So I'll just pass this one around. And
what is it?
Black walnut dye.
Oh, oh yeah,
so you can see there are little chunks of tree bark, and we use the nut, and you can use the leaves and the limbs, just all of it. And it smells, like my hand smells right now. But if it doesn't stink, it doesn't work. Yes. Are you going to fix me? We don't want people to see what size I wear, thank you. We do. Uh-huh. So I was asked the question, do we not use the nut? That's what we had always done in the past, but we did a little more experimenting, a little more reading, a little more looking, talking to other artists, other basket weavers. And I have to say, not locally, which is interesting. Most of what we've learned about weaving has been local, but what we've learned about dyes and stuff has been just through experimenting. So we really... We haven't learned a lot. It's just something that basket weavers sometimes keep kind of secret. It's your recipe. You know, that's your biscuit recipe. That's your whatever. So, yeah.
Can you use different colors, though?
Yeah. Yeah.
And my grandma used to make them like a red color and a blue one. And
yeah. Well, it was, I think they call them aniline dyes when I read about a bit of commercial dye. Y'all behave. We got a serious question. I know it's Dorothy. Dorothy Ice? Kidding. But, so she taught him? Oh, okay. So I'm just learning how to use berries where they, you know, where they work and stay on a basket. I've used elderberry and cochineal. But I haven't had a lot of luck. See, there's some little secrets in there of like how to get it to stay. So I haven't learned that secret.
Oh my goodness, what is a camera?
Why do we always giggle when things smell like poop or somebody farts? Or edit that out. Okay.
Now, Shawna, what did you say that you don't actually use the nut?
We do.
Some.
The husk that comes off the nut is really all you need. It's sometimes it's just easier to let them go ahead and rot without taking it off because we don't really, we're so lazy anymore and we don't crack black walnuts.
So how many colors do you use?
I try to stay, if I'm using those commercial materials I was passing around, I'm cool using any color at all. But for some reason, if I've taken it so much time to go and gather the stuff, oh man, I just want to use the natural stuff on it. So that's why this one doesn't have bloodroot in it much. You can see I had a little leftover, real faded bloodroot there because it was old cane that I had left over.
Yeah,
So, because I'm trying to conserve my blood roots for the year. So we've been digging it since May. And when I say since, a little bit, go again, get a little bit. In my freezer, I have a gallon thing almost full. That's it for the year. And so I'll be using that a lot this summer and getting ready for the shows this summer in September and October. So.
Yeah, it's important she has to count everything out. It's all counted out. Just got to have the count down.
Yeah, so I like the questions.
Well, I'll ask one.
Yeah, please.
Do you leave it in the dye a different length of time to get the orange color and then the brown color? Then
yeah,
the brown?
Another good question. With the black walnut dye, he's kind of the maker of the dye. I used to be the one who made all the dyes because I like to do it, and now he loves to build fires outside, so he makes the dyes a lot. But with how many times have you cooked this?
I cooked it 3 times, and I'll put her tomorrow. I'll put her her entry for the art show with Cain in there tomorrow. So I'll cook it one more time, and I'll let it set for about 2 months.
So we'll have to do before, we'll have to count how many around and make sure we have that many split and ready to go and go into the dye. So this one sits kind of funky. Sit right in public there. Okay, this is very cool. I know we have some teachers that are good. It's not a permanent. When I worked at Sequoia High School, those ornery kids gave me a permanent marker. And my first day there, I did blood red. Sentence diagramming. I should call him out right now. Okay, so when you're making a basket, well, don't do that. I don't want to do the teacher way. Okay, so you're going to have a lot of flat ones this way and a lot of flat ones that way, and you're going to turn them up, right? I bet that was loud. This is a terrible explanation. But everything that has the designs like this, the diamonds and all the different designs like this, they're by multiples of 12. So if you're just off one piece of river cane, you know, in your count, your design will not work out. And you're pulling your hair out and you're trying to figure it out and you're counting and counting. So Roger, because he's a former math teacher, talk about it, how it's higher math and all that stuff. I think I said it then, didn't I? That math's so easy. Multiples of 12. So usually my counts, I'm going over 3, under 4, you know, it's like 3 and 4 make 12. But he always used to brag about it because it does show we had a concept of higher math a long time ago, because these baskets date back to how far?
They date back a couple thousand years.
So that's kind of a cool concept, that we were multiplying our ancestors. So come on, questions.
Okay. Didn't they used to make baskets that you can haul water in?
Now see, we read that over and over and over about hauling water. And I'll give the examples I learned about it. On some of them, they were these double wall baskets. And they would sometimes, there are some in museums that, is it tar?
Pitch.
And they would line them with pitch. Because see, this is a double wall. And of course, water's going to get through, because just as a weaver, it's just going to happen. I mean, it's woven together. Water's going to get through the cloth. And this is woven much tighter than a basket.
River cane does swell. Whenever it gets wet, river cane does swell. So you would be able to dip water out of a stream or something and put it into something else. You would be able to do that. You know, it'd be quick if you had with the river cane like that, because it swells up.
But you wouldn't be able to walk a mile.
No, you wouldn't be able to walk a mile in
it.
No.
Because it would drip
no.
out. But we have seen them where they had pitch inside them, you know, and they would smear the pitch in there. So, but this would be the style they were talking about, not something like, you know, the vine baskets. Not something like this. So, even though it's a double wall, we can see right through it. So, obviously, you can see through this one too, but that's because this isn't the best weaving job. It was my first double wall I ever made. So
the variation in color on that is from those dyes, the one that you set down.
Oh, this one, yes.
That yellowish.
It has black walnut, bloodroot, and this was before I made my rule, you know, of what I was going to do with bloodroot. So it's natural, bloodroot, and black walnut, and it's just how it turned out. If you'll notice.
How do you finish off that top?
It's woven down and back into itself. So here, let me throw it. They're kind of like those, you know, those finger things you can put your finger in and pull? Oh. All right, I'm gonna throw it at you, ready? I'm gonna throw it at you. Okay. See how it goes down? And those are the most highly desirable by collectors, are the double wall, it seems.
It is one of the last remnants of that we found besides the basket making with river cane here in northeast Oklahoma, where we found where the hickory chairs, they were made with the backs and bottoms made of river cane. So that goes to show that we as Cherokees were incorporating it into our contemporary, our modern furniture and stuff, as well as keeping our traditions going with it. So there was a river cane source to support that, as well as the hickory. That's why it's hard to find good white hickory around here anymore.
Roger loves his river cane. Can you tell? Yeah, but it's true. So that's what we do now, is river cane most of the time. I do the buck brush just enough to make one basket a year because it's just brutal. So just to get enough for one basket took us 3 or 4 trips. So, and that's just a little bit. We have it all out back. So.
Do you have to soak it?
You do, and I guess I should have demonstrated how to weave while I was here, but yeah, you use a lot of water. You keep everything wet when you're weaving it. The hotter the water, the better.
You can either boil it 4 or 5 times or soak it for 3 or 4 months, and either way you'll accomplish getting the outer skin off of it.
That's the butt brush.
But if you watch the moon, it'll help you a little bit, but it's still a booger to get off.
We're such a professional act here. Give me your hand. So every night I have to pull his fingers. And I do, so our fingers won't crump. See, so our fingers won't crumple up because he's been skinning buck brush lately.
Yeah, that buck brush.
And I see those women from a long time ago with their fingers very contorted, I guess,
swollen.
You know, from and swollen and everything, and just think, wow.
They were strong. Those Kenwood women were strong buck brush weavers. I mean,
and I didn't say that. The women were from Kenwood who really got the buck brush really on the map.
Worse than carpal tunnel, huh?
Exactly. You know they had it. Oh, I used to just cry. My hands would hurt.
It sounds like she's weaving wire when she's doing buck brush. It's like, it's miserable.
So that's the big one you said was strong.
Yeah.
And that's an old basket. And it's a National Treasures basket, and it's Maxine Stick.
And so she's the one with the square bottom. How do you just...
See, this is...
No, ahead of time, how... What shape it's going to be?
Like
to make the base of it square instead of...
Yes. Yeah, okay, yeah. So, you know, you do your count...
License, I mean...
You do your count before. This was going to be a fish basket. But by the time I got to here, it was like, that's really too long, so I'm just going to turn it into a gathering basket. So, you know, you kind of have an idea. But on the double wall basket, yes, it already has a set bottom. When you come up, you can go as high as you want, but however big your bottom is going to determine how big your basket is. So, you know, a bigger basket, a bigger bottom. So, well, that was exciting. I paid about $800 for this one. Is that what it was? Because it's so old and because I knew who it came from, and we had money at the time. Yeah, there are. I've sold, gosh, you hate to tell people because they're like, man, you should be rich if you just work more, but that's it. There are just some people who want it, you know, that collect. Like I was the dummy that paid $800 for this, but I love it, you know? And that's why I don't pass it around because it's falling apart. But let me see, about $4,500 is the most I've sold one, no. Was it 4,500? But it was this big, you know, and it. Yeah.
It would have been a storage basket for. It was made like to hold quantities of grain and stuff. It's what she made it for.
Like a long time ago. Yeah,
it had a big bird design in the bottom of it. And
but he asked, "What do they do with it? It's a big showpiece, yeah."
Yeah.
They're in museums and stuff.
But that's what's fun about Shawna's baskets. She incorporates, she'll look at those big baskets from a long time ago with the, what we had before contact and after contact, where they're huge storage baskets for corn, grain, and stuff like that to live off of through the winter. So they had huge baskets and they had granaries that they'd protect. And so that's what's cool about Shawna's baskets. She incorporates that into the modern basket as well at the River Cane. That's what's really neat about it, and do the designs with it. And so these are the size of baskets that we had to have to live on a long time ago. Not
like twice as big
like
as the
this
big
right
pepper.
Here. This is more of a tourist kind of thing. It's great for pens and pencils and stuff. And you know.
And you bought that for me at Mississippi Chalk.
Yeah, this is Mississippi Chalk. I'm not making fun of it at all, but it's cool. It's double wall and everything.
It's on my shelf, real nice, yeah. And everything. But
yeah, the big pieces that she does is part of reflects from our prehistoric past. Like that basket there, as I was telling you, that'd be perfect to go walking in the woods to gather in. That's just a perfect size where, you know, you won't get snagged on stuff.
Yeah.
Just throw it over your back and go.
Yeah. So, that's, did I ever really make it clear what makers and basket makers and weavers are? It's this simple. I'm a basket maker because I go into the woods and I go gather. Or I can. It doesn't mean that I have to on every basket, right? But to be a basket maker, this is in Cherokee, North Carolina, and we're kind of talking among each other as basket weavers, and some people agree and kind of like it. I like it. A basket weaver would be one who can make a beautiful basket, but doesn't go to the woods to gather their own materials, or maybe buys all their materials from someone else who goes to the woods and gathers all their materials. So a basket maker is what, you know, I want to be more than a weaver. The weaving's okay, but I like the part about gathering it and figuring out the dyes and figuring it out. So thanks, guys. That's really all I have to say about basketry, unless you have more questions.
How long does it take you to make one?
That's a question we get a lot. And it just depends. Like this one, I had some cane already left over and split, so I was able to get it made in 2 weeks, get it dyed, get it made and everything. I finished it off right before we got here this morning. I was working on it, and that's usually basket weavers too. They're usually making it on the way. But if I'm going to make a great big one, we always say it takes a year to make a basket, and that's real philosophical, but it's true, because you gather the buckbrush in the winter time, you get your trees in the springtime, you get your bloodroot in the springtime, you can get your cane all year round, but it takes a year of seasons in nature to gather everything you need to end up with the final product like that. So that's why not a lot of people do it. And it really is hard. I've heard other people say this. It's hard to have a full-time job, you know, 9-to-5 job, and do it, because nature calls when it calls, and you have to go. And sometimes you just have a few weeks window. So.
Silly question, but does the cane stay green year-round?
If I split it, or if he splits it early when it's green, before, you know, after, right after we cut it down. Sometimes my baskets, when I weave them, will stay green for years. But if he cuts it like this, and I go and I stand there and I watch him, and then he tells me, not that one, not that one. So I mostly do this while he's cutting. And I look at pictures of my granny, and she's always standing like that. And it's like, I understand why. Your husband was a pain too. So, but when he cuts it like this and leaves it out, it turns this color. And this seems to be a more desirable color for basket buyers. They seem to like the tan better than the green. So that's the marketing end of it. And I hate
dye.
Yeah, and it takes dye better when it's this color. And I hate the marketing end of it. I hate that part of it. But so he does that.
How do you figure how to price one of your
exactly.
baskets?
That's how I feel every time. Yep, I know. He does it for me. And then when it starts getting too many hours to pay me like at least minimum wage, we just stop. I will say this one is going to go for $1,000 right here tomorrow, but it's because I have a buyer who, you know. But then you have that dilemma of, do I sell that one for $500 to someone else? You know, so I hate it. I don't do it. He does that for me. But I'm lucky this is a Cherokee Nation purchase, and I thank Cherokee Nation for that. So I'm able to charge what it's worth instead of what somebody will give me. So. And Cherokee, I have to say that one last thing. You know, because you don't want to sound like, you know, you don't want to be disingenuous and all, but I will say that as a weaver, that's something the Cherokee Nation really has helped us. And I don't mean any certain person or anything. I just mean as a nation. It's pretty cool the way they will go ahead and purchase things and say, go ahead and charge what Santa Fe would charge. And, you know, we like hearing that because that makes us feel like we're just as worthy as Santa Fe. And we have artists now going to Santa Fe and kicking butt in basketry and stuff. So, anyway, yeah. So that's all I have to say about basketry. And you can look up River Cain anytime on Facebook. It's Roger's page that he does. It's called River Cain Initiative, Cherokee River Cain Initiative, right? And he puts stuff up all the time. You sound like my mom. No, I'm teasing you. Some people do it. Some people do art full time, and if I could, I would. But no, darn it, I have to work too.
Shawna makes maybe 5 baskets a year, at the most 5.
Because I make big ones.
Mostly she makes 2 or 3 a year, and that's about it. 1, 2 is like that, and then 1 big one, that'd be about it. That's usually about what she makes a year. She doesn't make a whole lot, and she stays busy.
I'm a lazy basket weaver. No, I just, that's how long it takes, and no, I don't work. I mean, I don't have a 9-to-5 job, but I do have a full-time job, you know. So.
I think he was asking, too, about if you work, too, like if you do that.
Oh, okay, I thought you were being like my mom. Really, Shawna, that's all you're going to do? Yeah. What else do I make feather capes. What I like to do is find something in our history that maybe isn't being done a lot and study it and see if I can replicate it and make it. To me, that's really fun. So I went to college to become an anthropologist. And that's kind of what anthropologists are supposed to do, I hear. So I guess I'm kind of being an anthropologist when I do that. So that's what I do. But as far as art, that's about all I do is basketry and feather capes. Roger does other stuff, and he'll be back.
She helps me with my stuff. She always has an opinion, so, yeah.
So we are finally finished. How many times did I say bye? So thank you for coming. I'm really happy to see this many people that care about basketry and coming out to hear about it. And